consent.
And I would like to add that if you don't know this or don't have this, you can have it today before you leave this church, okay? The name of the song is A Wedding Day. It says, there's a stirring in the throne room, and all creation holds its breath, waiting now to see the bridegroom, wondering how the bride will dress. And she wears white, and she knows that she is undeserving. She bears the shame of history with this worn and weary maiden. Is not the bride that he sees, and she wears white head to toe, but only he could make it so. She has danced in golden castles, and she has crawled through beggar's dust, but today she stands before him, and she wears his righteousness. And she will be who he adores, and this is what he made her for. When the hand that bears the only scars into heaven touches her face, and the last tears she will ever cry are finally wiped away, and the clouds roll back as he takes her hand and walks her through the gate, forever we will reign. When someone dries your tears, when someone wins your heart, and says you're beautiful when you don't know you are, and all you've longed to see is written on your face, when love has come and finally set you free on that wedding day. Okay?
There's a stirring in the throne room, and all creation holds its breath, waiting now to see the bridegroom, wondering how the bride will dress. She wears white. Though she knows she's undeserving, she bears the shame of history, and this worn and weary maiden is not the bride that he sees. She wears white head to toe, but only he can make it so. Someone dries the tears, someone wins your heart, says you're beautiful, you don't know you are, and all you long to see is written on his face. Love has come to finally set you free on that wedding day. On that wedding day.
She has danced in golden castles, she has crawled through beggar's dust, but today she stands before him, and she wears his righteousness. She will be who he adores. This is what he made her for. Someone dries the tears, someone wins your heart, says you're beautiful, you don't know you are, and all you long to see is written on his face. Love's come to finally set you free. Finally wiped away.
your hand and walks you through the gates. Forever we will reign. Someone dries your tears, and someone wins your heart and says you're beautiful. Written on his face, the love has come that finally set you free. On that wedding day, on that wedding day, on that wedding day, on that wedding day.
Amen. Now that's the way a church service ought to be, a worship service. It ought to be filled with lots of music and about three or four specials every service. That's the way it ought to be. Amen. That's how we worship and we praise the Lord. So use your talents to the glory of God. Turn with me to Acts chapter 14. Acts chapter 14. As we look at the Word of God this morning, while you're turning there, two things very quickly. Number one is next Sunday evening, at the close of the service, we will observe the ordinance of baptism, and all those who are going to be baptized need to meet with me next Sunday afternoon at about 5:30, and we will have baptism in the evening service. So remember that, baptism next Sunday evening. Also, if you're not in a discipleship training class, then I invite you to come tonight. We begin in the Bible Explorers class with the book of Job. And the book of Job is a profound book. And why do people suffer? And why is there pain? And why do we have the problems we have? And Job gives the answer for that. Discipleship training begins at 5. And you can be a part of any class that you want to. The book of Job will be going on in the Bible Explorers class in the fellowship hall. So please, please be a part of discipleship training. Let's stand out of respect to God's word. We read in Acts chapter 14, beginning in verse 22. Verse 22. The Bible says, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. And when they had ordained them elders in every church and had prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord on whom they believed. And after they had passed throughout Pisidia, they came to Pamphylia, and when they had preached the word in Perga, they went down unto Attaliah, and thence sailed to Antioch, from whence they had been recommended in the grace of God for the work which they fulfilled. And when they were come and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them, and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. And there they abode a long time with the disciples. Father, bless your word. Open our hearts to receive its truth. And I pray today for that man, woman, boy, or girl that needs to make a decision for you of any kind, that this will be their day of victory in Jesus. And indeed, it'll be a wonderful experience in the grace and the power of God. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. When you begin to study in the Bible and you look at how faith really works in the hearts and the lives of people, there are a lot of folks who will say to me and to other people, well, you know, and have you ever heard anybody say this? You might have said it yourself. You would say, well, you know, I wish I had as much faith as he does. I wish I had as much faith as she does. I wish I had as much faith as they do. I wish I had as much faith as that group over there has. Well, I want you to look, because the Bible has told us in Romans chapter 12, verse 3, that God has given every man a measure of faith. Well, what does that mean? That means every person sitting in this room this morning, every person here in this place, every person who lives, ever has lived, ever will live, has been given a measure of faith. All of us have a measure of faith. Now, the indication in the Greek language is that word measure has to do with an equal proportion, because God is no respecter of person. I don't have any more faith than you have. You don't have any more faith than I have. You don't have any more faith than anybody else has. It's not the amount of faith that you've been given, because every person has been given a measure of faith which is identically the same under God, who is no respecter person. But the difference is in how this faith works in the hearts and the lives of people. We must understand that faith is not positive thinking. Faith is not the idea, well, everything's going to work out all right. Faith is not the idea, well, everything's going to be good and everything's going to happen right. You see, faith is not optimism. It's not even a feeling that you can do something. You look at yourself and you say, well, I think I can do that, or I can do that. That's not faith. Faith is not the thoughts of man applied to the actions of his life. Faith is not a hunch, or it's not looking on the sunny side. We like to talk about looking on the bright side of life and looking on the brighter things. Well, that's not what faith is. Faith is not looking at something that is brighter or better. So let's look at what faith really is according to the Word of God. Now, watch this carefully, and you need to remember this. Faith is getting a word from God and acting upon that word that God has given. Faith is getting a word from God and acting upon that word that God has given. Well, what do you mean, preacher? Well, you simply get a word from the Bible and from God, and you believe it. Let's say this to all who are saved. There was a point where you acted upon the measure of faith that God has given in your life. Amen. You see, the Bible said that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, that's a word from the Lord. And so, by faith, you came and you asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart, to take away your sins, and you confessed, you believed He died on the cross and saved you by His blood. But the measure of faith in you called you to respond and to say, hey, I want Jesus Christ as my Savior. I'm asking the Lord to come into my heart. So today, if you don't come and receive Jesus as your Savior, if you're lost, the truth is that you're not exercising the measure of faith that God has given into your life. Because you have a word from God. Now you must act upon that word that you believe. There are many, many. We could take a lot of examples, but think about this. You go through trouble. You go through difficulties. You go through problems. You go through heartaches and pains and disappointment. And you say, well, I just don't know if I can make it or not. Well, what do? You take a word from God, which is in the Bible, where Jesus said, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you, and I'll give you strength to do all the things that you need to do. Now, that's a word from God. Now, if I act upon faith, the measure of faith, then I will put my hand in His hand, and I will face whatever the problem is, and I will stand up under the difficulty of the world, and I will know that I'm going to be victorious because not of my faith, but because of the promise of the Word of the living God. Amen. Well, let's take that to another level. The Bible says, go into all the world and share the gospel. The Bible said, be ye witnesses. And then all of a sudden the devil comes up and he throws you a block lick of fear. And you say, well, I don't think I can do that. I'm scared to do that. I'm afraid to do that. Take the word from the Bible. Take the measure of faith and put it together and know that by faith you can do exactly what God has called you to do. Amen. And we're going to see that in the truth of the Scripture in just a moment. Acting upon the Word of God, you believe, and as that belief is appropriated to the Word of God, then that's faith. That's faith. You see, faith is exercised in a lot of ways. For instance, the Bible says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as a manner of some is. In other words, we ought to be in church when the doors are open. It takes faith to practice that which God has put in His Word. It takes faith to believe God, and the faith is the measure of faith that He has given into your heart and into your life. Faith is simply belief with legs on it, in which you put into motion what God has already said and believe God, who cannot lie. Amen. And believe God, who will bring to you the victorious truth of His everlasting Word. Well, let's look carefully at the text, because the Bible says that first of all, faith reveals God's plans for our life. You see, if we don't exercise that measure of faith, we won't ever know God's plan for our life. And sometimes, like the old Hebrew expression, that when the children of Israel came to the Red Sea, not one drop of water moved until the first Jew stuck his foot in the water. And at that moment, the water began to part. What was he saying? In that old Jewish proverb, it is simply this, that you must act upon that which you believe in order to know what God's going to do for you in your heart and in your life. You must act upon it. If you don't ever act upon it, you will never know what God is going to do in your heart. I believe today that God has given all of us a measure of faith, and there are untold people who are missing untold blessings because they have never acted by faith. They've only acted by the flesh. And they've only done what they felt instead of moving by the power of faith in the living God. So we must have faith in God. The song says, He cannot fail. He must prevail. We will have faith in God to know the plans that God has for our life. Now look carefully at verse 22, because he encourages us to continue. Notice verse 22 says, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. You see, the Bible never said we'd be absent from trouble. The Bible never said that we would not have tribulation. The Bible never said we wouldn't have problems. But the Bible did say that through faith in God, we're able to go on and to move forward and to stand tall under the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Not to run from the opportunity, but to embrace the opportunity whereby we are saved by His grace. Now, in verse 22, there are three words I want you to underline that verse. I want you to highlight them because they are the essence of faith itself. The first one is the word confirm in verse 22. You see, by faith, our lives are confirmed every day that we live. There are some denominations that have a confirmation ceremony in which someone who has received Christ as their Savior comes forward and they confirm the fact that they are a Christian. Well, that is ritual, but it is not substance. Substance is that by faith, our salvation is confirmed every day. How is it confirmed? Well, if you're truly saved, there's some things you will not do because the Holy Spirit is guiding and guarding your life. There's some places you can't go. There's some conversations you won't enter into. There's some books you won't read and some movies you won't see and some music you won't listen to and some things that you will not be involved in because your faith confirms the fact that you have salvation. You see, there are things that saved people do that the world will not do, and there are things the world does that saved people will not do. And oftentimes it is the acid test of our life as to what kind of fruit we're bearing according to the confirmation of our faith through the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. So as you take that measure of faith, every day is confirmed whether or not you have salvation. Every day. You say, well, I got up this morning, I didn't feel like I was saved. I felt like I was lost. Well, salvation is not a feeling. Salvation is faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. There again, taking His word and applying it to our lives. Because in 1 John chapter 5, he said, these things are written, there it is, the word of God, that you may know thereby faith that you have eternal life. Amen. And that life is present through the person of the Lord. It's not how you feel. It's not what you think. It's not what somebody tells you. It is because you have faith in the living, holy God that you are confirmed every day in your faith. So confirmation is the first thing. The second word that I want you to underline is the word exhorting. That word means to strongly encourage. Strongly encourage. You see, we are encouraged by our faith, because we take a word from God, and the word of God says that we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. And we know that's true. And when we see the measure of problems, difficulties, and the mixture of things that happen in our life, we wonder, what in the world is going on? I kind of like the story of the preacher that called on this dear gentleman to pray. And when he started praying, the preacher thought, well, boy, did I make a mistake calling on him this morning. But when he got through, the preacher got on shouting around. He started out and he said, I want to ask brother so-and-so to pray for us. And he stood up and everybody bowed their head. And he said, Lord, you know I hate buttermilk. Preacher thought, what in the world? Where's he going with this? I don't like the sour taste. Now, he wasn't like me. I love buttermilk and onion, buttermilk and cornbread and all that good stuff. But anyway, you probably don't. And I see someone going, yeah. But he said, I hate buttermilk. I don't like that old sour taste. I just don't like it. Then while the preacher waited and got a little more nervous, he said, God, I don't like lard. I hate lard. Lard's greasy, don't taste good. It's awful. I hate lard. Then he said, God, my mama used to make me eat flour when I was a kid in a teaspoon and said I hated it. Said, man, I didn't get so much I couldn't even talk. And the preacher thought, dear Lord, when is he going to stop? And then the gentleman said, but Lord, when you mix that buttermilk and that lard and that flour all together, makes the best biscuits in the world, and I love biscuits. And Lord, I want to thank you that you take the sour things of life, the unpleasant things of life, the hard things of life, and you mix them all together. And Lord, you form the things that we love, and by faith we praise you even when we don't understand what you're doing.
Amen.
Preacher said, amen, praise the Lord. You see, confirmation leads to exhortation where we are encouraged even by the mixture of things that we don't understand and we can't figure out. There's a third word. The word that you see in that 22nd verse is a word continue. Continue. How much we need to continue to be steadfast in the work and the worship and the will of the living God. How much we need to enjoy the blessing. If there's one word that is missing in our population in 2017, it is a word commitment. Commitment. You try to get people committed to be in church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Try to get them committed to be in Sunday school, discipleship training. Try to get them committed to read their Bible or to pray. Try to get them committed to do anything. And we say, oh, but I just can't. It's just too much. It won't work out. You see, the measure of faith not only confirms what we are and what we do, it encourages us and it helps us to continue. The great entrepreneur, Kathy, when he started out with his Chick-fil-A restaurant, said, we will not be open on Sunday, and we will not work on Sunday, and we will not go into any store on Sunday. And all the ne'er-do-wells came to him and said, you will fail. You won't succeed. You cannot make it in this world if you don't do it. You've got to be open on Sunday in order to be able to succeed. Well, Kathy said, I'm not going to do it. My Bible tells me that this is the Lord's day, and I'm to be in the Lord's house, and I'm to serve the Lord. I'm to be where God wants me to be, and to be in His services, and to teach His classes, and to do what God would have me to do. Well, the Lord surely confirmed it for him, didn't He? He not only confirmed it, He encouraged him, and He built more stores that were not open on Sunday. And then the Bible says that He continued to, of course, He's in the heaven now, but as long as He lived, and I think as well as some of these that He has in charge now, understood that Sunday is the Lord's day. It belongs to the Lord. We belong in God's house. We ought to be where God would have us to be. And you see, it's all a matter of the confirmation of our faith, the encouragement of our faith, the continuing of our faith. And I'm looking into the face of a bunch of people that some of you won't even be here tonight and some of you won't be here Wednesday night. Where's your measure of faith? Where is the measure of faith that stands that says, this is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it, and I will be where the Lord wants me to be. Amen. Well, sure did get quiet now. You see, this encouragement and confirmation and this continuing validates our salvation, and it gives us a victory over opposition, just like it did him in the business world. It gives you victory. When you keep on keeping on, the world can say what they want, but they cannot argue with the results of God in your life. And they cannot argue with what God does as they look upon your life as a believer, as a child of God. Right. Secondly, this faith enlists us to continue to serve, to roll up our sleeves, setting aside those things that God wants us to do and setting aside those things that God would have us to be and becoming what he would want us to. Verse 23 says, and when they had ordained them elders in every church, they prayed and they fasted. They commended them to the Lord on whom they believe. Submitting ourselves through fasting and prayer in the purpose and the power of God. Now, what does that mean? That means one of the things is that God has put upon your heart to serve. And I want to tell you this morning that if you're a God-fearer and you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and you aren't serving the Lord somewhere in his kingdom, then you're out of the will of God. You're out of the will of God because he's given to you a measure of faith. You say, well, I don't like this. Right? That doesn't matter what you don't like. It doesn't matter what I don't like. The Bible says that I'm to be faithful to the things that God has called me to serve him and to live for him and to live it to the max. Amen. Amen. That no matter what, it does not affect the decision that every person who's been born again has been set aside as a servant for the Lord Jesus Christ. And we submit ourselves through fasting and through prayer in the purpose of God. You see, the Bible says that faith reveals God's plan for our lives in salvation and service, in submission and in surrender. Secondly, faith sends us out of our comfort zone. Out of our comfort zone. Oh boy, how we like our comfort zone. Amen. Somebody said most people enjoy sitting around the fire, spitting in the fireplace and popping popcorn. Now that can be revealed in a different way. They like to kick back in their recliner. Like to potato out on the couch. Whatever it is they do, boy, that's what I like to do. Well, look here, I want you to give that up and I want you to come and go out in the name of the Lord. Oh man, that's out of my comfort zone. Out of your comfort zone? God's given you a measure of faith for you to go to people and places that are unlike yourself and cultures that are different than you. Look in those verses in verse 24 through 26. The Bible said that they went to Pamphylia, they went to Attaliah, they went to Perga, they went to Antioch. None of those people were like them. They were totally different than them. They thought differently, they lived differently, they acted differently. Everything was different, but they got out of their comfort zone and by faith they followed the living God. You see, we say, well, I'll do that as long as I can be comfortable with it. You know what? The greatest thing that ever happens in your Christian life is when you get uncomfortable in doing something and you must totally depend upon the living God. And God begins to work a work in your life. Oh, you say, well, I know how to do this. I know how to do that. I know how to do... hey, why don't you let God teach you something you don't know? Amen? Amen. Whereby you have to totally rely upon him. Look at verses 27 and 28. It says that this faith not only takes us out of our comfort zone, but it keeps us centered around the church. Look carefully. The Bible says, and when they were come and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentile. They rehearsed the good things of God. What do we do on Sunday? What do we do in Sunday school and discipleship training and worship service? We rehearse the things that God has done. And we rehearse the things that God is going to do as promises according to his word. Faith keeps us centered around the church. Now you, let me say this to you very quickly. You know, if you drive an automobile and that automobile's out of line and you're going down a highway, guess what? It's going to pull to the right. Or it's going to pull to the left, or it's going to do all kinds of silly things when it's totally out of alignment. And you see, you ever wonder why you're pulled to do these things that you ought not to do? Why are you pulled aside to leave God's house? Why are you pulled out there to be gone on Sunday? Why are you pulled out there to keep from reading your Bible? Why are you pulled away from prayer? You know why? Because you're out of line. You're out of line. That is, you're not lined up with God and the principles of the things of God, whereby He can drastically and powerfully change your life. When you're lined up with Him, guess what? The things may pull to the right, but it is only momentary because you're in a line with God. They may pull to the left, but it's only momentary because you are aligned with God. And you're back on track with Him, and you rehearse the things that God has done. And when you face a situation, you can say, hey, God took care of me back there. I know He's going to take care of me up here. Amen.
That's right.
He didn't fail me yesterday. He won't fail me tomorrow.
That's right.
Because I can put my trust in Him through an everlasting faith. You see, faith keeps us centered around the church. Three distinct things. Number one, we remember what God has done in our life. God ever done anything for you?
Yes.
Then I guarantee you that deserves our allegiance to Him when the doors of His house are open. You can tell me this and that and the other that you've got to do or you've got to be. But listen, you don't have to tell me. You're going to have to square it up with God. And you're going to have to get it right with Him. You got to remember what God had done. Secondly, you got to devote yourself to serve Him there. Where? In the church. In the church. Oh, you can serve God a lot of places, that's true. But the church is the one living organism that Christ gave Himself for that is alive on planet Earth to serve the living God. Now, all these other parachurch organizations are wonderful, but they're not the church. The church is that body of believers saved by the blood of Jesus, ordained for the work of God's kingdom. Thirdly, we're to lift our vision within the church and beyond the church. Expect God to do great and mighty things. Hey, as long as we can handle it, God's not going to be involved in it. I can promise you that. As long as you can do it, you don't need God. But when you start to attempt something that it's going to take a God miracle to occur, and you're willing by faith, according to His word, to believe Him for it, you will see the riches of God poured into your life. As long as you can plot it all out, figure it all out, put it on your little graph, associate it in your budget, work it up in all of your structure, it won't ever amount to anything. Until by faith, you take a step to do for God what you cannot work out, or you cannot position, or you cannot figure out. It's going to have to be a God thing. And God can do it by faith to lift up our vision to believe God. You see, sometimes we get scared about, well, what about this? What about that? Where's your measure of faith? Where's your measure of faith to trust God to go beyond what you see in front of you and to know that God has the ability? Well, you see, here the writer calls us to continue in the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ as an opportunity to report for duty. When you have faith and you have that measure of faith in your life, you say, Lord, what is it You want me to do? Here I am. My time's Your time. My time's Your time. No, I don't have to be out there in wherever today. My time's Your time. Lord, I'm here to report for duty. Secondly, you continue in the faith. It allows God to deal with you. Allow God to change your life and move your life. You continue in the faith, and it makes you available to the plan of God, or you continue to fail in your attempts to make it on your own. You see, the power and the promise of God is yours. He simply says to you, have faith in God. He's on His throne. Have faith in God. He watches over His own. He cannot fail. He must prevail. Have faith in God. Let's bow our heads together as we come before the Lord. Because God wishes to do great and mighty things in your life, but it's going to take you, me, exercising that measure of faith for it to be accomplished here today. There's some of you who have never asked Jesus to come into your heart. And this morning, God's given you a measure of faith. That faith is so simple,
You won't understand it. You won't figure it out. You can't describe it. You can't live up to it. You'll never be good enough for it. All that kind of stuff. Because your faith simply says to you, you need to step out. Surrender your will and your way to God. For others, it is God saying you need to be a part of that family worship day. You know the truth, and the truth will set you free. What about today? Will you exercise that measure of faith that can bring glory and victory to the Lord Jesus Christ? Father, speak to our hearts. Lord, as we sing this song of invitation, move upon we Christians first of all.